Hey guys. Well, that is a tough intro to live up to, but I will do my best for you guys today. Before I get started, I want to extend a very sincere and heartfelt thank you to Jerry and Glenn, Liz, Michelle, everyone here that's come together to make this incredible event, Sedona, possible for us. So if we could just take a minute and thank these guys. And thank you guys. I know it's early Sunday morning. I'm grateful you guys all came and are here. I'm touched. I'm honored. It is a real humbling honor for me to be here today. And I'm not just paying lip service when I say it's humbling, because it was about 3.5 years ago that I was waking up in a jail cell after a relapse to drugs and alcohol that all but took my life, quite literally. Here I am, though, today with all of you lovely people and sharing the stage with this incredible lineup of speakers. So to me, if that's not a testament to what's possible in life, you know, when we tend to our hearts, when we take care of ourselves, and when we begin healing our broken pieces, then I do not know what is. So it's very humbling for me to be here today. Let's see. 3.5 years ago, as I mentioned, I woke up in that jail cell, but that was not a first for me. It was, however, the first time I did so without any semblance of hope or desire to continue living. Hope has been very important to me in my life, especially during my addiction years, so much so that after I got out of my first treatment program many years ago, I got it tattooed across my knuckles, just to have that reminder right there for me. And I had an actually really interesting foreshadowing experience in regards to addiction, recovery, and hope. That happened during my very first relapse while I was on a trip to Rome in the mid-2000s. It was my second night there, and I was out to dinner with a friend. And I was a naive person in recovery. I was clean for a little bit over a year, and so I thought, well, maybe since I've been clean a year, I'm not really an addict. So, and a lot of people kind of test that. Some don't, and that's wonderful. Some of us do, and I found out very quickly that I am an addict. I had one drink at dinner, which led to several other drinks, and then next thing I know, I was on the bus around 2 a.m. going back to my friend's apartment, and I noticed this older man sitting kind of diagonally across from me, and he was just staring at me a bit, which I'm used to with all my tattoos, nothing new there. But about a moment or so later, our eyes connected, and he looked down at my hope tattoo, and he pointed to it, and he said, "Hope, it's the last to die." And you know, I didn't think much of it then. I was like, yeah, that's a pretty cool sentiment. But those words went on to become such a beacon of light for me in my life. As I mentioned, this happened during my first relapse, but it was not my last. The next several years of my life became this vicious cycle of getting clean and then ultimately relapsing because I wasn't doing the inner work I needed to be doing. I'll talk a bit more about that later. But it was during those darkest times, during these relapses, that I would hear this older man, as if he was saying it to me right there in that moment, "Hope, it's the last to die." And that was the inspiration each time that would help me pick myself back up and start the healing process over. That is, until the very last relapse that happened about 3.5 years ago, which I'll come back to that as well. So just a quick disclaimer for you guys. If you haven't picked up on it yet, the majority of this talk is going to be in relation to drug and alcohol addiction. However, I invite you guys to use it as a light to shine on whatever it is that you struggle with in your life. Maybe it's depression or food, sex, shopping, anything that causes any sense of dis-ease in our lives is completely applicable to what I'll be talking about today. It's that dis-ease that creates these broken and fragmented pieces in our heart. And whether you're an addict or not, that's the things that keep us in a place of unnecessary suffering. A lot of the times it's underlying, but it's still there. I was interviewing a wonderful Trappist monk. His name is Father Thomas Keating several years ago. And during the interview, I mentioned to him that I'm in recovery from drugs and alcohol. And he kind of laughed, this 80-year-old playful man laugh. And he said, "Well, I'm in recovery too, but I'm in recovery from the human condition." Right? So I was like, oh, yeah, that makes sense. So it's kind of like the Buddha taught, you know, in his first noble truth, that if you've taken a human birth, which we all have, it's inevitable that we are going to experience some pain and suffering in life. It's just part of the deal. But as the Buddha also went on to teach, the degree to which we suffer is much more in our control than many of us are aware of. So that's what I'm going to be talking to you guys about today, working with the pain and suffering in our lives so that we can heal these broken pieces and in turn learn to love ourselves and others without holding back. So again, thank you guys for being here this morning. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. That was the very cliched story of my younger years. I did start with drugs and alcohol a bit later than most people I knew. A lot of my friends started dabbling in junior high school, 9th, 10th grade. It wasn't until about 11th grade for me that I began my experimentation, but I very, very quickly made up for lost time. I was also playing in bands at this point in my life, as well as over the next several years. And so with that, I would be doing touring around New England, where I was living at the time, and being introduced to new, different kinds of drugs, and I was always very happy to experiment and take a lot of them. So it was a very quick progression for me that I went through the stages of addiction. You know, I went from the experimentation to the regular use, the abuse, and then at the age of 19, I was a full-on addict. And that was the course of my life for the next several years. Pretty much from 19 till 24, it was just this horrible downward spiral. And I went deeper into my addiction, and with that came the fear, the anger, the hurt, the sadness, self-cutting, suicide attempts, all kinds of good stuff. And it was at 24 that I just was literally like a shell of a human being. That's how I felt. So I finally checked myself into a detox. And when I was there, I quickly realized that this was the first time in many years I'd gone more than a day or so without putting some kind of substance into my body. And I was really grateful for that. I had known for many years that I did not want to live the way I'd been living. I just didn't know what to do about it. I was so lost. So I really took advantage of being in the detox unit. And then from there, I went into a 28-day inpatient program. And from that inpatient program, which was a great experience because I learned that I wasn't just completely batshit crazy. You know, I have an actual disease of addiction. And I needed to hear that because I thought I was just insane. So from there, I went into a halfway house where I lived for 2 months just to kind of continue to support myself in my recovery. And I began getting the material things back in my life, a job, an apartment, a car, a girlfriend. And that's what I based my sense of recovery on, was the material things I was getting back in my life. I was not really doing any of the inner work, which is where our real recovery happens. And so that was why I got into this vicious cycle of relapsing that I already talked about. But it was about a year into my recovery when in Rome, relapsed the first time. And then over almost probably maybe the next 8 to 10 years, it was just this cycle, get clean, then relapse, then go to detox, start all over again. Each time, though, I heard that man in Italy, I heard his voice saying, "Hope it's the last to die." And I would pick myself back up. But that wasn't until this very final relapse that I experienced, when even his words meant nothing to me. I was just completely shot and gone and had no desire to live. So that's just a little bit of my story. And it's important for me to share that. I don't mean to be like Captain Bring Down and the Buzz Killers up here on Sunday morning. You know, because I was here yesterday and I saw Kyle and I think it was Chuck. I mean, they were just killing it. It was great. It was funny. That was awesome. But, you know, it's important for me to share kind of the darker side of life and our spiritual paths as well, because it's all part of it. So, and the other reason I want to share kind of candidly with you guys about that is I want people to know that no matter how far gone you might feel, I truly believe, and I think I, along with many others in recovery, are a living example that until your last breath, you can turn it around. You can come back. There is always hope. So it's very important for me to share that with you guys. So the very last relapse I had, I don't have a lot of time, but just to quickly tell you about it, I woke up in that jail cell. The next morning, I checked myself into detox. While there, I was completely hopeless, completely broken, feeling empty. And to make things worse, I found out I lost my job that I somehow managed to hold down for 5 years working with kids that I loved, but I lost it rightfully so. I also missed my brother's wedding, where I was supposed to be his best man. So You know, these things just on top of my already hopeless, broken feeling just added up, and it was the darkest time in my life, for sure. My detox clinician wanted to send me to a treatment program outside of Connecticut, where I was at the time, just to get me away from everything. And I was fine with that. You know, I had nothing. I literally had no desire to live. I was too chicken shit, to be honest with you, to take my own life. So I agreed to go to New Jersey. There was a 2-day window between the bed being available and me leaving detox. So I proceeded to get blackout drunk for those 2 days. I barely remember getting on the bus in Hartford to leave. There was a layover in New York where I don't remember it happening, but somehow I made it from bus to bus. I did lose my luggage, which to this day I still don't know where it is. And the reason that's kind of funny is when I woke up that next morning in treatment, you know, besides just feeling completely hungover, a clinician assistant came in and he threw a pair of shorts down on the ground. He was like, "Wake up, you need to put those on because you pissed yourself last night." And that's how I started treatment, you know, and that wasn't the first time something like that's happened to me either. But so as I started that treatment, again, hopeless, broken, empty. But what I want to share with you guys now is 5 things that took me from that place of despair and hopelessness to where I'm at today, the life I'm living today. And trust me, it is not perfect by any means, but in comparison to where I was at, it is just filled with much greater peace, acceptance, love, and healing. So the first of those 5 things is, what are we going to start with? Inspiration. It was about 2 weeks into treatment that one of the clinical directors saw a medicine Buddha tattoo that I had on my left leg. And that led him in to bring in a copy of the book Finding Freedom by Jarvis J. Masters. And I was familiar with Jarvis's name because the wonderful Buddhist nun Pema Chodron often talks about him in her Dharma talks. I think she's written about him as well. And she's actually his teacher, too. Jarvis is a innocent man, very, very innocent, living on San Quentin's death row. And he has been there for over 30 years now, which is a travesty. That's a whole nother talk in and of itself. But reading Finding Freedom was a very powerful experience for me. You know, Jarvis candidly talked about his experience being there on death row, yet how after he was introduced to Buddhism, he began to find his own freedom. You know, he started to do that inner work that I wasn't doing. And along with that, he went on a few months later to take his Bodhisattva vows. And for those who don't know, I mean, those are vows we take where we aspire to do everything we can to awaken ourselves fully in this lifetime so we can help all other sentient beings awaken and in the process relieve their suffering. And along with those vows comes the practice of ahimsa or nonviolence. So, I mean, these vows are no small thing on any given day for any person in the world, but let alone someone living on death row in San Quentin. So reading about this man who did this was the inspiration that I needed to pick myself back up and finally begin that healing work, to really start going inside and touching these places that I've been so scared to touch for most of my life. So along with hope, inspiration has been huge for me. The trick I found is keeping myself open to it. You know, it presents itself to us in so many different ways in life, whether it's a stranger on a bus, in the pages of a book, listening to music, spending time with family, a piece of art. I mean, it's always around us. I think we'd all agree that inspiration is really the force behind all the great things we do in life. So that was a big one for me, was finding that inspiration and keeping myself open every day to that. The second thing is surrender. When I came home from treatment, I had to move back in with my parents because, I mean, I had nothing. As I said, I lost my job. My car was repoed when I was in treatment. I had to file for unemployment, which was a first for me, because even through my addiction, I was still functioning for the most part, and I held a job down since 16. So that was really humbling for me. The one thing I did have, though, when I came home was surrender. So in the 12-step fellowships, they have a saying, the gift of desperation. And that, to a lot of people who haven't gone through addiction, might sound a bit counterintuitive. What they mean by that, or at least in my experience of it, was that I was so broken down from my using that I did not have that ego fight left in me to keep pushing away help, to keep pushing away the tender parts of my heart. So in this process of being so broken down, I was actually gifted this chance to really begin to lay aside some of the armor that I'd been placing for many years over my heart that kept that pain at bay, so I didn't have to go there and touch that. But again, that was what was keeping me sick and suffering. And along with that, also, I was able to start surrendering a bit of my ego self, the material Chris that wants to be the director of everything. So what I started doing then, and it's something I've done basically every day up till this point, and I intend to keep doing it till my last breath, is each morning before I meditate, I say a quick prayer or an aspiration, something to the effect of, and I say it just for clarity, I mean, I say we can call it God, spirit, Brahman, Buddha mind, Christ consciousness, whatever you care to call it, it's all good. But so I say this prayer, and I just simply ask that this higher power help me lay myself aside as much as possible so that I can make way for a deeper wisdom to guide me through my days, and that wisdom would guide me to be of service to others in whatever way it sees fit. You know, the fact that I am alive today is truly a miracle, and that is not lost on me. So every day, the most important thing for me is how can I give back? How can I help others? So surrendering myself in the process has been huge. The third thing is self-compassion, and this is one that can still be very difficult for me at times. My self-loathing runs very deeply through my years of using. When I would live in apartments on my own, it was so bad. I was so disgusted by myself that I literally couldn't have mirrors in my apartment because I just could not stand to look at myself. Or when I would walk into a store, you know, that have glass doors, I'd always kind of look down so I didn't see my reflection. Or if there was a painting, a framed painting on the wall, and I knew like I'd be crossing or walking by it and see my reflection, I'd look away. I just couldn't stand myself to that degree. And sometimes I still catch myself doing that. It's way less frequently, but you know, it's a daily process, progress, not perfection. So something that's helped me tremendously with cultivating that self-compassion is meditation. And there are no shortage of different kinds of meditation, so I'm not here to advocate for one over another. I always tell people, find the one that works for you, or find the ones that work for you. Guided meditations are great. Loving kindness meditation is very powerful for this. Walking meditations, whatever it is. For me, Vipassana meditation has been very helpful, which is basically you just follow your breath as you're breathing in, you're breathing out. I don't have enough time to like do a guided practice with you, but that has been really important for me because what I find is that as we do that, we go and we connect to our deeper self and we are able to begin disidentifying with our thoughts. A lot of teachers will talk about our thoughts like clouds passing in the sky. So the thoughts are the clouds and we are the sky. The thoughts are always temporarily passing and we are this permanent ever witnessing sky. And that's the experience I found and I think a lot of other people have had with meditation. We have the thoughts, they still come up. So I still have the thought on any given day, like you're fat, you're ugly, you know, what service can you really be to anybody? You know, these things still happen periodically. But today, thanks to meditation, I'm in a place where I'm not on autopilot, so these thoughts aren't dictating my well-being, for the most part. It still happens, but way less frequently. So when that thought comes up, I'm able to witness it come up instead of feeding into it and being like, oh man, you are fat, you are ugly. You know, it comes, I witness it coming, and then it goes on its way. So in that little subtle shift, there is this spaciousness that arises that along with that comes this great liberation, this sense of freedom. Same with emotions. You know, if you're feeling angry or sad or hurt, thanks to meditation, I find that, sure, I still have the emotions that come up, but I am no longer identified with that. Instead of I am angry, I am hurt, I am aware of anger arising in me. I am aware of hurt arising in me. Doesn't mean that the feelings go away, but there is a spaciousness. And again, along with that comes a lot of freedom. So for me, that's been tremendous in cultivating greater self-compassion. The fourth is a practice I call unconditional love and acceptance. And this is inspired by actually a Dharma talk I had heard Thich Nhat Hanh give. Most of you probably know who he is. If not, he's this wonderful Vietnamese Zen monk. And in the talk, he simply said, hold your pain the way a mother would hold a newborn baby. And that just resonated so deeply with me. So I started actually working with that and kind of created this little practice around it. I'm just going to give you a quick story so you can kind of get a hands-on experience of the practice itself. So it was several years ago, I was at my parents', and my mom and I will sometimes talk about my time in active addiction, and we do it in a therapeutic way. It's kind of healing for both of us. And this one time, though, my mom shared this story with me. that I'd never known happened until this point. And I was at my parents' house, and I was blackout drunk. I had just refilled a prescription to Klonopin, which is a benzodiazepine. And when you mix that with alcohol, it can lead to death. At the very least, it significantly intensifies your drunk. And I had a very bad habit of mixing those two. So my dad, I guess, went into my bag and took them when I wasn't looking. And later on, I went to get them. And I saw they were gone, so I confronted my parents in their kitchen, and my dad let me know that, you know, they'd taken them. So in my blackout state, my brilliant idea was to grab a big steak knife out of their kitchen drawer, walk out to the driveway, hold it up to my throat, and threaten to kill myself if they didn't give me the pills back, which they did, of course. I mean, what choice did they have? And I took the pills, and I took off, and it was a few hours later, they found me like on a grassy knoll somewhere and brought me into an emergency room, and that started another one of my detox rehab experiences. So as my mom told me this story, God, it was the closest I had come to actually going through withdrawals without going through withdrawals. I was aware of my head, it started throbbing, my back hurt, my chest tightened, my stomach started to churn. It was just horrible. I felt nauseous. But I didn't want to let on to my mom, you know, this was what I was experiencing, because I know she wasn't sharing that story with me to hurt me in any way. And I felt I had already caused her enough hurt that I didn't want to cause any more by her seeing the pain I was going through. Now, I think she's actually watching this at home right now, so Mama, I love you. and my dad, too. Yeah, I'm really blessed. I know a lot of people in recovery, and they lose their families because of the way they lived. That wasn't the case for me, so I'm so blessed to have them. I'm getting a little emotional just thinking about it. But anyways, so I excused myself from the room without letting on that I was feeling any pain. I went up to my old bedroom, and I sat there, and this is where I did this practice. The first step was I closed my eyes, and I allowed all of the thoughts and all the emotions to come up and just say whatever they had to say. I allowed myself to feel whatever I had to feel, watching them. I didn't feed into them and buy into them, but I watched them, and I let them just run their course. So, I mean, thoughts like, you're a piece of shit, like, you don't deserve to live, all these just terrible thoughts, you know, how could you do that to your parents? And along with that, these physical nauseous feelings and the chest tightening, it was just a terrible experience. But I let it come up, and I let it run itself out. Usually, this practice doesn't have to be used on just heavy things like that. It can be used on other things. So usually it takes maybe a minute or so for this cycle to run itself out. In this case, it was like 10, 15 minutes. And once I felt like it had exhausted itself, the next step is I close my eyes and I mentally say to it, or actually, I'm sorry, that's the third step. The second step is where the Thich Nhat Hanh thing comes in, where I picture these thoughts and these emotions, and sometimes you'll get an image that comes along with them, sometimes not, it doesn't matter. In my case, I saw a spike strip like the police used to stop a speeding person. I don't know why I had it, but anyway, so I took that, I took the thoughts, I took the emotions, and I wrapped them in a blanket, the same way a mother would, a newborn baby, and then I mentally imagine myself holding it and cradling it. For some people, that's a little too personal. So what I recommend to them, you know, because the pain can be so great, is that you still wrap it like you would, but you place it in a baby carriage and you rock it. That way you're still tending to your emotions, but it just creates a little bit of freedom for you in the process. So the third step, though, is with eyes closed, I will mentally say, or you can verbally say it if you want, something to the effect of, I would say, I'm aware that you're here, and I'm sorry that you are feeling, you know, as much hurt and pain as you are. I'm saying this to my thoughts and my emotions. And I let them know that my heart is open to them, that I will be there with them for as long as they need me to, and that, again, I'm sorry they're feeling the way they are. Something to that effect. It usually changes when I do it, but whatever I'm feeling in the moment, whatever works for you. And that's where the magic of this practice happens. What we're doing when we do that is we're completely flipping the script on how we usually deal with our pain and our hurt. Because for most of us, the natural tendency as a human being is to suppress it and push it away, or to tell ourselves, all right, I'll come back and deal with that later. But I think if most of us are honest, later never usually comes. So dealing with our emotions right there in the moment and allowing them to be there, allowing them to come up and release their energy rather than continuing to suppress them down, it just releases all this pent-up energy, and it's an extremely liberating experience. The fifth thing is a mantra, I am loving awareness. Same with meditation, There are no shortage of mantras you can use, and I always tell people, find the one or ones that work for you, and I use many myself. But I love the I am loving awareness one. This is a teaching I've heard Ram Dass talk about quite a bit. And so, you know, I do the other practices, but I am still a human being, and I still get caught up in these thoughts. But I find when I'm using the I am loving awareness mantra, it helps me to get anchored literally into this place of loving awareness. So as with any mantra, I start out by consciously saying the mantra, and then with time, the mantra becomes its own cyclic repetition in your mind where it's kind of doing you. And then with the I am loving awareness mantra, I find that on a good day, I will have this experience where everything falls away, and it's literally a non-dualistic love. So anything that enters my experience is loved. How could it not be? You know, I'm loving awareness literally in that moment. Everything is loving awareness. It's a really beautiful non-dual experience. A quick story, I was at a Slayer concert a few years ago. I love Slayer, and I'm guessing I could count the number of Slayer fans here on one hand, and that's cool, man, to each their own. That's all right. But so I'm at this Slayer concert, and I'm doing the I Am Loving Awareness mantra, and there's people moshing around, and there's 20-foot-high flames on the stage, and, you know, death metal blaring. And I had this beautiful experience where I literally was loving awareness. And I looked around at a Slayer concert, and it was all perfect. It was all love, even at a Slayer concert. So it's a very powerful practice. So those are just five of the things. I mean, there's others, but those are five of the big things in my life that not only attribute to me being alive today, but allow me to be of service, to allow me to come and speak at events like this, volunteer my time in detoxes and rehabs and just give back any way that I can. You know, they help me to be a better version of myself today. I don't have much time, but there's one final story I wanted to share with you guys really quickly. It happened in March of last year, and I want to share this because I feel like it brings everything I'm saying full circle today. So it was the day my book, Indie Spirituals, was released in March of 2014. I was out in New York City doing a book launch party and signing, and it was just a really emotional and great day. You know, coming from where I was to having a book put out was pretty crazy. But so it was actually the end of the night when I went back to my hotel room that I think probably the coolest thing of that day happened to me. I was checking my email before going to bed, and I had a message in my inbox from a friend that I had not talked to in several years. We both had our own issues going on. It was a bit of a toxic relationship, and we knew we needed to go our own ways. But so I had this email in there, and I don't have time to read the whole thing, but I brought a part of it. Because it's so touching to me. She wrote, "I just got home from an incredibly emotional experience. I stopped into the bookstore tonight to buy your book. Johnny Cash was playing in the background, and I nearly lost it when I found you in the stacks between A Course in Miracles and Ram Dass. I thought to myself," that's nice, right? But this is the part right here. She wrote, "I thought to myself, I used to look through the obituaries for your name, and now I'm looking through the stacks in a major bookstore for you. My God, I don't have the words. I'm just so glad that you're well." Yeah. And yeah. And I cried like a little kid when I read that, because she was so right. On any day, you know, my name could have been in the obituaries the way I was living. But when I cried, you know, they weren't tears of sadness. They were tears of joy and gratitude. And not just because I realized I'd really come to the other side of what I had been through, but that I realized, holy shit, if I did this, there is absolutely no reason that anyone else cannot do this. You know, we're all able to offer this world a better version of ourselves if we take a little time to go inside, and it, you know, it's a little uncomfortable, but to tend to our hearts, work with these broken pieces. My favorite author, Charles Bukowski, once said, "We are here to laugh at the odds and live our lives so well that death will tremble to take us." And that is my sincere hope for every single one of you in this room today and for all people everywhere, that we're able to heal ourselves, that we get a little vulnerable with our pain, and that we heal these broken pieces so that, indeed, death will tremble to take us. Thank you guys so much. Thank you.